Hey, good morning, church. As many of you know, we're here in Florida for spring break, enjoying time with our family, and also managing all that's going on in our community with the coronavirus situation. We as leaders felt it necessary to be good neighbors and to assist our community with this crisis, as well as to protect our church family by not holding on-campus services this week. We believe this is indeed best, so thank you for cooperating, and thank you for joining us this morning for online worship. I pray it blesses you and speaks to you. Our good friend Galen Blum, who is a former senior pastor, church planter, and current church consultant, is our guest speaker. I will be back with you at least in some form next week to share God's word. We will communicate to you another update on this situation on or before Wednesday of this week regarding steps for the future. For now, please pray. Pray for our nation. Pray for its leaders. Pray for our community. Pray for our church and its people. Pray for God to use this crisis in a powerful way as he can do. And pray these things, always remembering 2 Timothy 1:7 that says, "For God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power, of love, and self-control." Remember, we're still the church body without coming to the church building. So let's go and be the church this week. I hope you enjoy our worship service this morning. God bless you all. I hope to see you soon.
Well, hey, everybody, it's so good to see you. Let's worship together in this place.
Open up the doors again. Let the King of Glory in. His kingdom will never end. Oh, I know that you are good.
Yeah.
Break the darkness with light. Dead place come alive. Oh, I know that you are good. I know that you are good. You will have my hallelujah.
Hey.
You above and the highest name. All to you I surrender. With every breath I take, make my life your prayer.
Here we go.
Yeah. Spirit of the living God, fire burning.
And amen. I've absolutely been loving this series called Hear. We are learning as a church what it looks like to hear the voice of God, what it might sound like, maybe something different than we've ever experienced before. He speaks through dreams. He speaks through a still small whisper. He speaks through other people to us. And it's just so beautiful that he loves us so much that he would desire to communicate with us. It's incredible. We'd love to sing a new song today, and that new song is called Better Word. And there's things about God, not only does he speak himself, but there's things about him that speak. If you understand what I mean, his hand, think of his hand speaks power. The hand of God is power, right? His heart, you think about the heart of God. The heart of God speaks something. The heart of God speaks love. When he came and he died on the cross and sacrificed everything. When Hebrews says that Jesus is the mediator of the new covenant, he's the representative of the new promise, and that his blood speaks a better word. And we have that tonight. We can receive that tonight and accept that and celebrate it. So as we sing this new song, I hope these words impact you. I hope they make a change in your heart and your perspective about what it means to hear the voice of God as his blood is speaking a better word. Amen.
The precious blood of God
is rewriting my history.
Love you, Lord. So much for choosing to worship with us. We're so glad that you're here. If you haven't, now is a good time to download our church app. You can download the church app by searching the Brook Church in the App Store on your mobile device. You can watch our services online, give to the church, as well as receive important updates. Be looking for those push notifications and Pastor Mike's emails. You can also stay connected with us on social media.
Thank you, Ashley. It is great to be here today, and I can't tell you how excited I was when Mike approached me and says, hey, would you speak for me over spring break? And we're going to do this series called Here. And I thought, wow, there's really nothing else I would rather encourage Christians with than the reality that God wants to lead us, guide us, direct us in a very personal way. And the developing an ear to listen and to know how to respond to the promptings that God is continually stirring in our hearts changes everything about our spiritual life. It changes our journey from being just time we start the day with in our Bibles to enjoying God's presence with us throughout every activity of the day as we continue this communication with Him. But I have to be honest with you. I grew up in a tradition that would never use the word, you know, here. God didn't speak to us. In fact, he gave us his word, and that's how he talked to us, and then we talked to him in prayer. And that's kind of the Christian life, you know, in black and white. And the first time, given my tradition, that I actually had an impression that I was sure was God, it actually scared me to death. Now, I don't know about you guys and how God began to break through or take you into that personal interaction where it became more than the scripture, but his spirit interacting with the scripture to really move us towards him. But for me, I had gone to Bible college, and I had gone to Bible college just because I wanted to learn a little bit more about the Bible. I had absolutely no interest in going into ministry. So I finished a year, and when I was at that age, I thought, you know, if you study the Bible for a year, you'll know it. So I finished the first year, and two things happened that made me really want to come back to where I did come back. The first was this. I got a scholarship to play basketball at the school, so my tuition was covered. So it wasn't going to cost me anything, and this was nice. The second was I met a girl named Tammy, who's now my wife, and I just didn't want the thought of living 1,000 miles away from her. So I went back the second year, but halfway through that year, it's Christmas break, and I'm deciding, you know, do I go back? Because the school I was at, if you weren't going to be a teacher, they had education degrees, or a pastor, there really weren't any other degrees. And I didn't want to study the Bible, and so I'm praying through this, and I'm up in my dorm room, and it's the first time God really broke through. And he didn't give me an answer, he gave me a question. And the question was this, it's like, you know, why won't you trust me with your whole life? And I'm, you know, after I'm kind of getting over the, you know, who's there, and it's not that I'm hearing a voice, but I know God's with me. And I'm starting to say, you know, what do you mean? You know, I want to serve you with my whole life. And he says, well, why won't you be a pastor? And it's like, well, I don't think you have to be a pastor to serve you. And I still don't. But then he says, you know, it's like, well, what if that's what I have for you? And I'm kind of into this. And the next few minutes is probably best described as God kind of taking me to the woodshed and really pulling back and saying, you know, why is it, Galen, that you won't say yes when you clearly hear what I'm asking? And it really came down to this. And I told God, I said, you know, God, I says, I don't think in ministry I can provide for my family the way I want to. And I don't know how many of you know, it was a year or 2 years ago, Mike invited me to preach on the kingdom of God. And it was, seek ye first the kingdom of God and all these things will be added unto you. And so at that moment, when I finally got to the point of saying, okay, Lord, if this is what you have for me, you know, I will do it, that God deposited the promise. And he says, Galen, he says, everything that you think you're giving up, I'm going to give you. And if you want to hear that story, you're going to have to go back into the archives of the message, because God fulfilled that promise in miraculous ways. But when you start to interact with God at such a personal level, now, I'm not saying you're going to hear a voice, And I'm absolutely saying you're never going to hear God lead you to do anything that is contrary to the scripture. But there is a relationship, and central to any relationship is communication. And it's not just communication, it's conversation. It's two ways. It's interacting with God. It's sharing all of life with him and realizing he's there with you. And he is willing to guide you, prompt you, lead you into every activity and thought if we will let him. And so for so many of us, this kind of relationship is really foreign to us. And the question I want to, you know, raise today is, why is that? And we want to go to the scripture. We want to see through the 23rd Psalm what it is that God has lifted up to us as a vision for the kind of relationship, the way he wants to interact with us, to get an idea of the kind of relationship that David had with God, that God is inviting us to have with him. And in the midst of this, I want us to be honest about the challenge. Is once you start to hear God speak and you lean in to his leading, you kind of want that with every decision, don't you? It's like, wow, God, you know, this last time I was so sure of what you wanted me to do. And then you get into another situation or you're going through another struggle, and it's as if God just goes silent. And I don't know about you, but that's a struggle sometimes for me. And the church fathers have kind of coined that the dark nights of the soul. And so part of in our understanding how to listen and respond to the voice of God, what should our response be when God's voice seems to go silent? When you know he has spoken, but you're in a moment or a season, a time in life where it seems to just that you've gone spiritually deaf. What is God doing in those circumstances? Because I think David addresses those. Now, tonight we're only going to be able to take a 10,000-foot view at the 23rd Psalm. And the 23rd Psalm is one of the most read scriptures, recognized scriptures, quoted scriptures in all of time. And I think there's a reason for that, because at the very heart of it is David is describing the relationship that God wants with us. It's really, really beautiful. So if you have your Bibles with you tonight, open them with me to Psalms 23. If not, the scripture will be on the screen where we read the word of the Lord. A psalm of David. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Before we jump into this, let's pause and just ask God to really be our teacher tonight. Lord Jesus, thank you so much that you are a God who wants to communicate and speak to us. So Holy Spirit, we would ask that you would be our teacher tonight, that you open our hearts and our minds to the truth of the kind of relationship that you want with us, how you lead us, how you guide us through life. And Lord, when we enter the valleys, when we're confronted with enemies, God, how you are at work even in those times when it feels like you're distant. So Lord, tonight may we leave with a better understanding of how you are at work in our lives and where you are leading, where you are guiding us, even in the moments and times that we can't hear your voice as clearly as the times when we know it's you. So God, draw us closer to you tonight. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. To really fully appreciate this scripture, or this psalm, we need to understand who it is that was writing it. So David is the author of this psalm, and David had a life that you could say was full of highs and lows, you know, ups and downs. And yet at the end of it, in all of his faults and failures, God described him as a man after his own heart. And why is that important? It's important because no matter where you've been or where you are, if you are feeling distant from God, there were times that David experienced that. David knew that. And yet in the end, God describes him as this soulmate. And that's really where God wants to take each of us, into this personal relationship, regardless of our spiritual highs or lows, regardless of our moments of rebellion and our seasons of just total surrender. We can be and we can enjoy the same kind of relationship that God had with David. So what kind of challenges did David have? Well, David was anointed to be king of Israel as a teenager. He became a servant to the king, Saul. He ends up marrying the king's daughter, a princess. That relationship kind of reflected in-law relationships, because Saul actually tries to kill David. David goes into hiding. He finds himself popular with the kingdom because, if you remember the story of David and Goliath, this is David. He knew the power of God. He knew how to trust God. He knew how to walk by faith. But David also had moments where he drifted from God. Though he was a man after God's own heart, he committed adultery. He committed murder. He struggled to be the father of his children. He had rebellious kids. Absalom actually led a rebellion against him, where David went into hiding. And so you see the challenges that you face and that I face, the ups and downs, the rebellions, and the submission were all a part of David's life. And in this psalm, David isn't making a prayer request. He's simply describing his relationship with God. And it's a beautiful thing because in it we find the very heart and spirit of the kind of relationship that each of us can have with God. The psalm moves through David's maturation journey. It starts off after the very first verse. David speaks of God in the third person, and then it moves to the first person. It moves from the pasture to the parish, to the home, to where God is his host and caring for him. It describes the ups and downs of life, the valleys, the challenges of enemies that face us. And so we're looking at this from a 10,000-foot view, and since our topic is hearing, I've divided it into two parts. The first half, the first three verses, I'd say when God speaks, or we would say this is life viewed from a mountaintop. This is, you know, the high life. This is when everything's going well and we're feeling close to God and blessed by God. Then the second part, I would call, you know, what we learn from the highs in life to listen and learn about God's heart for us and God's desire for us. Then there's the low life. There's the valley perspective of life. And this is the times where God seems distant or God's gone silent. And what do we do in these moments? And in these, I would say, we learn and we lean in to what we'd heard God say before. And so from the first perspective, we are listening and learning about God. From the second perspective, we're really learning more about our heart and where we are in relationship to being able to remain true to God even when all the positive stimulations, you know, in the storms, we want to be as faithful to God as on the sunny days. And that's not easy. And so in this psalm, there's all of life. And how we respond to it. And where David ends is where God wants to take us, where he says, you know, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Through the highs and through the lows, David found that God was faithful. And so how does he communicate all of this? So we want to begin by understanding when David says, the Lord, that's significant. Because in the English, we don't recognize it, but the word in the Hebrew is Yahweh. This is the actual name that God gave himself, and this was a name that was so revered that it was never spoken by a Hebrew. In fact, when a scribe wrote this name for God, he would bathe before writing it and then burn the pen he writes with it. That's how reverent they held that name. The typical word would be Adonai or Jehovah. But David intentionally uses this elevated name for God, the name that God gave himself when speaking to Moses from the burning bush. When Moses asked, who should I say sent me? And God said, I am what I am has sent me. And so in this, David is encapsulating every other name given God. It encompasses the idea of El Shaddai, the Lord Almighty, Jehovah Rapha, the Lord who heals, Jehovah Jireh, the Lord will provide, Jehovah Shalom, the Lord of peace. David is holding up a transcendent view of God, and that is so important. Because part of the reason sometimes we don't lean into the voice of God is God's word isn't weighted any more than any other voice. And if we want to have the word of the Lord separated from all the other voices in our words, we need to give ear and tune into the fact that when God speaks, it ought to be like, you know, I'm going to age myself, E.F. Hutton. those of you who are my age know that. Since when E.F. Hutton speaks, people listen. We want to lean in. And so what David does is he says, the Lord. Because if all we've done is make God in our own image, we don't give God the attention, the reverence that we need to separate his voice from every other. And so let me ask you tonight, you know, how weighted is the word of God to you? How hungry are you to really be able to discern the difference between God's voice and your own conscience? Have you learned to really separate the Spirit's promptings from your own desires? And David starts by saying the Lord, because he's laying out for us who God is. And then in the very next phrase, he talks about what God does. And in this, David talks about the transcendent nature of who God is. And then he presents him in a very personal, caring manner, because he says this. He says, the Lord is my shepherd. So now he is saying, it is God who is the one who cares for me. And I think as the Spirit was working in David's heart to record this, he probably had David reflect back to his time as a shepherd boy. And he remembered the extent that he would go to care for his sheep, to provide for them, to guide them, to make sure that they were protected and felt safe and could rest. And it's probably as if a light goes off in his head, and it's like, that's the perfect analogy, that God wants to be our shepherd. And so he says, Yahweh, anything and everything that you can comprehend of who God is only the beginning of all that God is your shepherd. And why is that important, that we have this elevated view of God and this personal understanding of his care and his desire to walk with us and guide us and protect us? Because if we don't see God as bigger than any challenge that we face, we won't lean in to his word. We won't want to know what it is. We won't see his wisdom as being any greater than Oprah's. We kind of get to this point where it's like, okay, you know, this looks like a good idea. But when you start to understand who it is that the scripture comes from, that the Spirit is reinforcing in your heart, and you know that his desire is to care for you and love you and provide for you to the degree that a shepherd did his sheep, it changes everything about the dynamics. You know, Jesus did the same thing when he was teaching us how to pray. He holds up these two polar ends of perspective of who God is. He says, what? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. So where David started with the transcendent nature of God and went personal, Jesus starts with the personal, our Father, and moves to the transcendent, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, set apart, revered, treated as uncommon. There's no one like you. And this is so essential to have us step into the trust that's required to actually enjoy the fullness of the relationship that God's invited us into. That God wants to have this personal, intimate relationship with us. He wants us to be able to fully trust in his guidance in our lives. If you look at it, it says, the Lord is my shepherd. So we listen to what God has to say to us about who he is and what he's doing for us or with us. God, the Creator, the Alpha and the Omega, wants to be your shepherd. Regardless of where you've been or what you've done, Jesus uses the same analogy, doesn't he? He describes himself as the good shepherd in John chapter 10, verses 10 through 15. Listen to the relationship where Jesus uses the same imagery that David did. He says this, he says, the thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that you may have life and have it abundantly. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for his sheep. He who is a hired hand and not a shepherd who does not own the sheep sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and flees. And the wolf snatches them and scatters them. He flees because he is a hired hand and cares nothing for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. Now listen to the relationship. I know my own and my own know me. Just as the Father knows me and I know the Father, I lay down my life for the sheep. This is the relationship that God wants to have in our life. And he ends in verse 27, and he says, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. Now, the imagery of this is in Jesus' day when a shepherd would bring his sheep in and they put them in a pen. Every shepherd put their sheep in the same pen, so they mixed the flocks. And in the morning, or when the shepherd was ready to take his sheep back out, he would simply go to the gate and call his sheep. And the sheep had developed such an intimate relationship that they knew his voice, and that they would separate themselves from the other flocks and follow their shepherd. And that's the kind of relationship that Jesus is saying he wants to have with us. He wants us to be so intimately aware of his voice and his heart for us that when he calls or when he leads, we follow and we leave whatever it is that we're doing to stay in step with the shepherd, because the sheep knows that with the shepherd is where he will be safe. And that's where David goes next. He says what? The Lord is my shepherd. And so what did he learn? I shall not want. Wow. He's saying this, that in the relationship with God, you can fully rest because he knows the shepherd will take care of every need. I don't have to worry about a thing. I don't have to be concerned because the shepherd is going to take me from point A to point B, and I don't have to worry about anything that might attack us in between on the journey because my shepherd has it under control. Now that's what we're really all looking for, isn't it? There's a famous song. I think everyone will know it, even the generations. Rolling Stones called what? Satisfaction. Why is this song listed by Rolling Stone magazine as the second greatest song ever written? Ever written. It's a song about this search that can't be found. You know the words, don't you? I can't get, no, I won't sing. Satisfaction. Though I tried and I tried and I tried. And I try, what? I can't get no satisfaction. David is saying, do you want to be satisfied? Do you want to be content? Do you want to be able to rest? He's saying the answer is in tuning your ear to your shepherd and understanding that he is the one that is proactively engaging with you if we will tune our ear to hear. It goes on and it says, he makes me lie down. He leads me besides still waters. God is speaking. God is leading. God is directing you into the fullness, the abundant life that he desires for you to have and you to know. And what keeps us from it is our willingness to give ear to the Spirit, to stay in step. Scripture also says what? All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned to our own way. And this is where we run into challenges in life. When we choose our way over God's way, when we don't allow the word to have the weight that it needs to have in our lives to protect us and to guard us from the traps that Satan wants to set for us and has set for us. And so David says, God, the creator of the universe, the Alpha and the Omega, loves you enough to be your shepherd, to be your guide, to have you learn his voice, to have you be able to stay in step with who he is and what we are to learn from what we hear, the scripture saying, the Spirit reinforcing in our lives, is that in that we will find full satisfaction and contentment. We will have no need beyond what God provides for us. And that's a great place to arrive. It is that kind of relationship that God wants to have with us. Now, there's some of you right now that you're feeling that stirring. You're thinking to yourself, you don't know what I did last night. You don't know where I've been. You don't know how I've offended. God can't want me back. And the beautiful thing is that Jesus tells a parable just for you about the shepherd who's willing to leave the 99 to find the one. That's how much God loves you. Is he will pursue you to the ends of the earth. He will do and has done whatever is necessary to reconcile him. And I would encourage you tonight to not suppress what you sense God doing, his wooing you back into a deeper relationship, his wooing you to say, stop trusting the things of the world. Put your trust in me. Realign with my word, and I will embrace you, and I will lead you into the fullness of life. Remember who it is that's writing this? An adulterer, a murderer. So whatever you've done, there's no worse than what David's done. And yet David, God says, we became so close, soulmates, man after my heart. Why is it? Because David learned to enjoy God for who he was. He learned to trust God for who he was and understand what it is that God is doing in his life. He is leading him into this place of fullness for his glory and your good. Whatever work is necessary for you to embrace the forgiveness, to accept the drawing of God, I would challenge you, don't say no. Say yes to what God is doing, because he is the answer. And the anthem of the boomers was, I can't get no satisfaction. The answer for the boomers is trust Jesus to be your shepherd, to lead you, to guide you. Tune your ear to his voice and let him embrace you, love you, show you who he is. This is the relationship that God wants. And the challenge is when you start to get up in the morning and you open your Bible and you have your coffee and Christ together and you feel loved by God, the times that you get up and you start to feel like, my prayers just seem to be bouncing off the ceiling. When you come to worship and every other Sunday, Aaron's been able to lead you into the throne room of God. Now it seems as if, your worship just isn't doing anything for you. No emotion, no stimulus. What's going on? Most likely you're in a valley. And David is really honest. It's not just all, still waters. Life has its storms. And if we go to verse 4, I would call this a dark night of the soul. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. Life is full of valleys, isn't it? St. John of the Soul coined these dark nights of the soul. He was a priest in the 1500s, and he describes the maturation journey that God moves us through valleys. He takes us through seasons where he seems to disappear, where his voice seems to go silent, where our worship dries up, where the scriptures stop speaking, where our desire for God seems to just evaporate, when it feels as if our prayers are bouncing off the ceiling and we can't get any sense of direction because it feels as if every spiritual light in our life has been extinguished. I don't know if you've been there. I can say in my life, I know two seasons that I would describe very much as that. Hard, lonely, dark times. And in these, what is God doing? Where when God's speaking, he's wanting us to listen, to learn, to trust him, to learn to be sensitive to his voice. When he goes silent, I think the other is he wants us to learn about where our heart is. What else isn't there? Am I showing up on Sunday for the goosebumps or God? You know? Am I really willing to follow God through the storms as well as through, you know, the still waters, as well as long still waters? Because so many of us, we're on board as long as God's giving us what we want. You know what? It's like, hey, this is working out pretty well for me. But as soon as a valley comes, as soon as an enemy pops up, it's like, wow, wait a minute. Is God still worthy of your worship? Is God still worthy of your praise? Is God as good in the prosperous times as in the problem-filled times? And it's in these moments that God has us do that deep dive into our own soul and face the current reality of what it is we really want in our relationship with God. And have we let him be God? Worthy to say, Lord, whatever is needed, wherever you need to take me in order to conform me, to refine me into your likeness, if it's into the fire, I'm willing. And it's only in the times where the trials come and the voice of God is not so clear and the warm fuzzies aren't there that our heart reveals to us the reality of sometimes the darkness that God is still wanting to work out in our lives. And it's in these times that what we must do is evaluate whether it's the feeling or the faith that we're going to hold to. Because when the feelings leave, do we run back to the vices that stimulated us before we came to Christ? Do we go back to take care of ourselves, to stimulate the flesh in order to feel alive? Or will we stay the course and believe that God is up to something good in my life, that he hasn't abandoned me, that he is trying to take me to a whole new level of understanding and faith and awareness of who I am? It's kind of in this moment where you find out who you really are. Now, I don't know about you, but sometimes I hear, and this is going to sound terrible, you know, you hear of the shootings and you think, and you hear the people who run to help, and then there's those who run to hide. You know what I'm saying? And you wonder, I don't know, maybe I'm alone in this. It's like, what would I do? What would I do in that moment? And I want to believe that, you know what? Let's get him. But not until I've been there, and by God's grace, I'd never have to go there. But you know what I'm saying? In the silence, it's God saying, will you still worship me? You know, am I running to God or am I running away? Is my service to God a bartering? God, I'll serve you as long as you take care of me. You scratch my back and I'll scratch you, or if we really let him be God in our lives. And it's through these times where God almost withdraws every physical sense of his presence, the stimulation in our souls that cause us to go, am I willing to honor God if God never shows up in the way he has in the past because of who I've come to believe him to be, because he's worthy of my surrender, of my submission, because of who he is? I can trust that he has my best interest at heart. When God takes us through the valleys, when we feel abandoned, it is what we have learned when he has spoken to us that allows us to echo the words of David that says what? I will fear no evil. My faith will overcome the fears that I have, that I'll never be satisfied again, that God isn't enough. My faith will help me lean in to what I have learned of who God is. Because we can't ever doubt in the darkness where God's led us in the light. And when we only learn as to whether or not we really have placed God at that position of honor in our lives through the hard times, when God pulls back. And when you do, There's a reassuring, there's a personal faith that's birthed in you that goes, wow, I do love God. I don't know about you, but I've gone through enough of these times in life where Satan comes and he starts with the lies, and it's like, you know, God's not enough. You've deserved, you know, we can just say a piece of cake when I'm on a diet. We won't go to the really dark side. But you know how Satan starts to say, ah, you know, you deserve this. Go treat yourself. And you know, there's those moments where you just kind of go, you know what? I know I'm not going to be satisfied with that, because here's my challenge. Here's my problem. I really believe this. I really believe God's worthy. I really believe God's good. And I'm going to feel horrible if I do that. I don't know about you, but there's something when you come through that temptation and you were faithful, that you go, wow, God has taken me a long ways. And he's going to even take you further than that. What I want you to hear is it is natural to feel abandoned. Why does David say, I will fear no evil? Because fear is a natural response. Why does David say, for thou art with me? Because it's natural to feel abandoned. It's natural to feel that God's withdrawn, that you've offended him, that he's given up on you, that you weren't good enough. And those are all the lies that Satan wants to pour out into your heart. And that's the voice that's going to start to scream in the silence at you. And what you've got to do is look at what David had said. You know, I heard God and I learned this about God. And in the silence, in the valleys, I am not going to doubt what God has shown me in the good times, in the bad times. Does that make sense? And so he says, you know, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. No matter how abandoned I feel, I am going to hold to the truth of what God has said, that I will not leave you. I will not forsake you. I'm with you. Even if you can't see me, feel me, sense me, hear me in that moment, I am there. And I'm going to go old school on you here for just a second. I'm trying to find a clock that lets me know where I'm at in this. I got 1 minute. I'm short already. I'm sorry, I was looking at this time, and I thought I had 7 minutes and 37 seconds for the last half hour. All right, I will quit. Here is the classic poem, Footprints. As I was walking along the beach with the Lord across the dark sky, flashed scenes from my life. For each scene, I noticed two sets of footprints in the sand. One belonged to me and one to the Lord. After the last scene of my life flashed before me, I looked back at the footprints in the sand. I noticed that at many times along the path of my life, especially at the very lowest and saddest times, there was only one set of footprints. This really troubled me, so I asked the Lord about it. Lord, you said once I decided to follow you, you'd walk with me all the way. But I noticed that during the saddest and most troublesome times in my life, there was only one set of footprints. I don't understand why, when I needed you most, you would leave me. He whispered, my precious child, I love you, and I will never leave you. Never ever during your trials and testings, when you saw only one set of footprints, it was then that I carried you. That's classic, because that's the heart of our questioning of God's faithfulness to us. What are our takeaways today? God desires an intimate relationship with you. Believe that with your whole heart and pursue him wholeheartedly. When you have trouble hearing God, you may be holding worldly things too tightly. You may still have the pleasures of the world be as weighted in your life as your relationship with God. And we need to untangle ourselves from some of those things to when in the silent times we don't return to our favorite vices to stimulate the flesh, to feel alive when God isn't quite enough. God's silence helps you see how worthy of your worship you believe him to be. Now, if you're not in one of those dark nights now, I want to encourage you, press in to listening to the Spirit reinforce in your mind who God is and what he's doing in your life. He's drawing you into this personal relationship, this family relationship that will strengthen you through every trial. If you will listen and learn, you will then learn to lean in to who God is, and you will find, as David, that God will always be faithful when we are faithful to follow. He will lead you into that promised land. That is his promise. That is his invitation. My hope is that you will listen to the Spirit and respond with a yes, Lord, today. Let's pray. Father God, forgive me for being long. Lord, I just believe there's someone listening here or online that just needed to know that you haven't abandoned them, regardless of their unfaithfulness to you. You are still worthy to be faithful to them. Lord, that you are wooing us into a relationship that's brand new, or Lord, back into a relationship that we've walked away from. God, I pray that you would draw all of us into a hunger to want the same kind of relationship that you enjoyed with David, that we would trust you to be our shepherd, to lead us so that we, like David, could declare at the end of our days that you have been faithful, that surely goodness and mercy is ours as we dwell with you forever and ever. Thank you, Lord, for your care for us, for who you are. We are so unworthy of the kind of relationship that we get to have with you. So, Lord, from this day forward, may we not look back, but look forward and lean in to what you are speaking and saying to each and every one of us, so that we might know your voice and be willing to, without question, follow it wherever you lead us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
We're going to continue in a time of worship through offering. You can give to The Brook on our church app, on our website, or via PushPay. We'd also love the opportunity to pray for you, and you can submit your prayer requests on our church app.
When silence falls, I hear you call in the secret place. You still my soul with quiet joy in a wide away. In the middle of the night, I look up to the sky and I can hear you singing over me. In the fire and the flood, I know that I am loved. I can hear you singing over me, yeah. You spoke the earth with just one word, and you hold my heart. My every step, my every breath is a work of art. In the middle of the night, I look up to the sky and I can hear you singing over me. In the fire and the flood, I know that I am loved. I can hear you singing over me.
I know that I am loved as I can hear you singing over.
There's nothing like